Hi everyone, so shall we begin the session? And well, as we've already introduced ourselves, I'm Gerard Delanty, Jasper Chalcraft, we've also introduced himself, and perhaps Augusto, you might just introduce yourself.
Augusto Santos Silva, from the University of Porto, Faculty of Economics, but I am a sociologist.
So just roughly what we're going to do, we're starting a half an hour earlier because we ended the last session earlier, so I think that's fairly clear. So we'll run for about 90 minutes and then we'll have a 15-minute break and resume the second session at 6 o'clock and finish at 7:30. And in each session there are two papers. The academic members of the consortium present the first one, and then there's a complementary contribution by the invited academic stakeholders, and in that case it's Augusto Santos Silva who is the second speaker. And then the second session we have Dominique Pulo and a paper by Harmon Maiz, who unfortunately can't come for family reasons. However, he has a paper which will be presented in summary, and we have a short English version of that paper too. And Jasper's going to sum up that paper. So that's roughly what we do, what we're doing. And again, just to establish clarity on what our rationale is, we're not just simply presenting papers and talking about them and then doing something else. The whole idea is interactive, in that we're hoping to identify thematic areas that will then be the focus for the rest of the of the research project. And we're not going to find, of course, arrive today at definitive ones, but it would be nice if we had some indication of what might be relevant issues around what we're mostly talking about here. That is memory and heritage, and memory and identities. Broadly speaking, issues relating to memory, heritage, and the focus of the first round is specifically memory and heritage. And our particular paper, which maybe I can now go to, which is quite a long paper. It's something like 13,000 words. As I think you know, we have produced six papers altogether, the academics, in this consortium. And our particular paper is about transnationalism. It's about looking at heritage in terms of it being transnational. And that could be looking at heritage that already exists, looking at the transnational dimension of heritage as it currently exists, or rather a shifting of a perspective, what happens to heritage when it does become transnationalized. And our sort of problem basically is this: heritage mostly is something that's been conceived of largely in the terms of nations, and something that's very often ethnocentric. But looking at heritage from a transnational perspective, what happens? Is it possible to arrive at a more reflective and critical understanding of heritage? And maybe why this? We've argued that there's been a huge shift in the human and social sciences, especially in the human sciences, in recent years, towards the transnational, right across the board in all disciplines, relating to all different topics. But that hasn't really been very much applied to the problem of heritage, and in particular the European heritage. We're talking in general more about heritage, not specifically European heritage, but of course European heritage is a particular interest of ours. Now, we're asking the question, would a focus on looking at heritage as transnational help, for example, minorities to see themselves in new ways? Is it possible for heritage to be something more inclusive than what it always is, if it is looked at from a transnational point of view. Now, what we're not saying, that transnational heritage is somehow better than national heritage. However, immediately two things. One thing that we are saying is definitely a transnational perspective possibly does open up, shall we say, a better view of things, something that's better. But we're not making a basic normative divide between, say, national heritage is bad and now heritage needs to become transnational, and that's a good thing, because we are also aware of some possible limits with the possibility of a transnational heritage. But we could also say, and I think it is our argument, that national heritage could be conceived of in transnational terms if we looked at it in a slightly different way. And we're also aware of the sort of conservative underpinnings of the notion of heritage, and in particular the non-English words that are generally used for heritage, like the notion of patrimony. And I think it's not a coincidence that the English word heritage has a broader resonance in languages other than English, because it doesn't necessarily convey the notions of patrimony. For example, the shift to looking at the past in terms of the traumas and the negative aspects of the past. So we are saying that transnationalizing heritage carries a sort of a challenge for identities. And is that always a good thing? We think that there are positive aspects to it. We think that a more transnationalized conception of heritage may be more in keeping with Europe's past if we look at history in a particular way. Maybe it can offer contemporary societies a more cosmopolitan orientation to their identities if those aspects could be identified. And you know, one trend in current literature is one we talked about it earlier this morning, one that emphasizes more the dark aspect of the past, the negative things, the traumas of the past, the Holocaust, etc., etc., the dark side of history. And many commentators are now saying that should be the focus of heritage, how to deal with the wounds of the past, with heritage of that's one of violence, exclusion, etc. But could looking at heritage from a broader transnational perspective open a more cosmopolitan interpretation of heritage that wouldn't only necessarily be focused on the dark side of history? Without, of course, saying that doesn't play a role. So somehow we want to see if heritage could be conceived in ways that avoid, on the one side, the rather conservative notions of patrimony, for example, the received wisdom of the past as reflected in a particular view of heritage as unproblematic and always positive and nice. And on the other side, the more negative conception of heritage, all about now trauma. Is there somewhere in between that transnational perspective of heritage might open up? So in a way, that is the background. So the paper which I'm in the difficult position of chairing the session and presenting a paper, so I don't want to eat up more time than it's been allocated to me. So in the paper we explore different conceptions of the tie between heritage and transnationalism. And if I could we present this paper together, the first step is to refer to what I suppose is a dominant trend in literature on transnational memory, transnational heritage. For the moment, we're using heritage and memory interchangeably. There's a distinction, but let's not explore that at the moment too much. There's a lot of interesting literature, which I think has probably kicked off a good deal of the debate on transnational heritage and global memory. And roughly what we want to say is that, yeah, that's all very interesting, but transnational memory is not quite the same thing as global memory. And a classic work that sort of crystallizes the notion of global memory is literature on the Holocaust, especially an article and book by Levy and Snyder, who write about the Holocaust now becoming a global memory, and no longer a memory that's specific to the Jewish people or specific to the countries where it was perpetuated, something that's maybe specific to Germany, but something much, much wider. And as perhaps some of you know, in 2001, the European, I think it was the Council of Ministers, decided that there should be European Heritage Day based on the Holocaust. What we say is that yes, this is interesting, an important dimension of transnational memory, the transnationalization of the Holocaust. Slight difficulty with it is that virtually all the empirical evidence relates to the United States. And exactly how global is it in the end of the day? Somewhat doubtful that could be the best possible paradigm. In any case, we review that. We argue that the notion of global memory or a global heritage probably overstates the what heritage can really do, that it can really become something global. And instead, we prefer to go for what is undoubtedly the lesser argument for a transnational notion of heritage, not necessarily global. And we're not mincing words here. We're not saying that transnational is another word for global. Transnational here has a slightly, shall we say, reduced meaning than something global, something that covers the globe. We think a transnational conception of heritage is something achievable, where it is something to be achieved, and secondly, is actually part of the makeup of many memories. But maybe a global memory is something unrealistic, both as something to be achieved and something that actually exists. That's the first step to look at that, and then say transnational perspective is something else. And Jasper now is going to make a few remarks on the second step of our argument on transnational heritage as opposed to global heritage.
Okay, thank you, Gerard. So, what happens to heritages when they transnationalize? One of the most obviously transnational heritage projects is, of course, UNESCO's World Heritage List. Yet there are numerous case studies that detail how designating something as World Heritage has too often just been used for place marketing, city branding, and national tourism promotion. This is because, we argue, World Heritage has become an integral part of the global economy of prestige. By contrast, a genuine process of transnationalizing heritage and the recognition that it gives to mixed up and complicated pasts shows that a more equitable and less exclusionary relationship with the past is in fact possible. Of course, one of the key ways that heritage has been used recently is within development. This is both welcome, but it's also problematic. The ways in which it operates give an insight into which pasts are deemed suitable for conveying ideas of unity and transnational identification, and also how this kind of transnationalization masks a neo-colonial development agenda that can ignore local understandings and uses of heritage. Of particular interest is how certain pasts are more amenable to universal messages than others. This is the case in Tunisia, where Roman archaeology has been used to locate Tunisia as part of a wider, more secular world, one whose archaeological remains are selectively used to demonstrate past cosmopolitanism and to create a heritage citizen in the present. Ancient history is good value for such imaginings, establishing incontrovertible value and guaranteeing tourist interest. What they don't appear to do, though, is to critically engage with the broader and more problematic pasts, such as the legacy of European exploitation and colonialism, whose sites of violence rarely attract significant foreign interest. So, how might heritage professionals and activists actually practice the transnationalisation of heritage? One way may be to simply abandon representing those collective identities that museums and memorialisations have tended to reify. Heritage, even in its most overtly transnational form of UNESCO's World Heritage List, makes distinct identities even more evident. Heritage professionals and museum curators can instead focus on the objects and places, finding narratives that emphasise other kinds of identification, that create less ethnically bound forms of cultural memory. Other strategies involve privileging the heritageisation process itself as a way to overcome contestation of the past. For example, the Swedish NGO, Cultural Heritage Without Borders, has been running projects in the Balkans aimed at creating networks which override such ethno-nationalist identities, but that also promote the idea of heritage as both a right and a resource. A crucial element of success in their regional restoration camps, run twice a year in Gyrokastra, has been the way engaging in physical restoration and reconstruction creates dialogue amongst the camp's participants, and thus also a transnationalisation of perspectives over both the deeper past and more recent conflict. So we think that Cultural Heritage Without Borders shows that heritage is a process that can actually help build new communities and break down divisions. It is also a process that is more open to grassroots representations than history ever was. For example, Alan Rice describes guerrilla memorialisations of the Atlantic slave trade in the British city of Lancaster and also in Bristol. These can be as simple as simply doing graffiti and vandalising a statue of the local philanthropist Richard Colston and graffitiing slave trader all over him. It's a clear rejection of the regional narrative, which is of a city founding father, and we don't talk about his role in the transatlantic slave trade. That's a statue of Richard Colston, but sadly without graffiti on at the moment, and then an advert for a sale of slaves from Bristol of about the same time. Similarly, Alan Rice describes the activism of the Slave Trade Arts Memorial Project in Lancaster, which since 2002 campaigned and then worked with locals and civic authorities on a co-curated memorial to the dead slaves to try and bring back what was an ignored history of the city. Of course, not all grassroots activities are positive. Recent months, or the last couple of years in fact, have seen the widely publicised destruction of Iraq and Syria's heritage by Islamic State. Nimrud, Palmyra, the Mosul Museum, and many horrifying examples that we can demonstrate and show, not least, of course, the murder of Dr. Khaled al-Assad earlier this year, not very long ago this year, and the destruction of the temple of Baal Shamin. These provocative acts of iconoclasm are, of course, terrible. But the West would do well to remember that its own actions have resulted in the removal and sometimes destruction of cultural property from these very same sites. For example, these two Lamassu, or winged gods, one of which is now in the British Museum and the other in New York's Metropolitan. Now, back to you, Gerard.
Thanks. So in the next step in the argument, we try to identify a conceptual language for unpacking transnationalism, in particular with respect to memory, heritage, and we propose three concepts. The first is very much inspired by a really great book, Michael Rothberg's 2009 book, Multidirectional Memories. So here, basically, the idea is that from a more generally transnational perspective, memories can be seen as interacting with each other, and of particular importance here is the way in which especially two, but possibly three, really important memories interact with each other. Some of the points that Jasper's been talking regarding slavery, the Holocaust, and those memories relating to the Stalinist purges and crimes. That's more relevant to the historical experience of Central and Eastern Europe, the Holocaust, and slavery. We're interested in the Holocaust, and the historical experience of slavery was more the focus of Rothberg's book, how they interact with each other, and thus how one memory should not be seen in isolation from another one and sort of running its own course, but what actually happens. And I think this is a really important argument, is that memories interact with each other. And as they do so, they undergo change. So hence this idea of multi-directional memories. And this argument, it struck us in writing this paper that it seems to support the general notion of transnationalism in general, and in particular the transnationalization of memory and heritage. The notion of memory as multi-directional, so these memories not just clashing with each other because they can't be translated into each other, but their interaction and how one borrows from the other, as opposed to being unidirectional, suggests a more complex mosaic of memories transforming each other, and that too could avoid the problem of, you know, which was worse? Was Stalin worse than Hitler? Is it all a question of numbers? And there's a huge debate on this. But it might, and there are many different perspectives on that question, which we're not going to address, obviously, but it could be a different way of looking at them in terms of their interaction, for which a transnational perspective would be necessary. And that becomes all the more interesting when it's combined with the perspective on slavery and how that could be incorporated into the picture. And I've just mentioned here three obvious kind of narratives of memory. So maybe there's huge scope for research on the relationship between such memories, which have generally been seen as having separate histories. So that would be one perspective, multidirectionality of memories and their subsequent interaction. But this idea also demonstrates another concept that's very popular in sociological and historical literature, the notion of entanglement. The idea of the entanglement of different pasts. That might deepen and expand the idea of multi-directionality. The notion of entangled history, especially in history, in transnational history, stroke global history, the idea of entanglement has become very, very central very recently, the last 10 years, possibly even less. And what that means basically is that histories are interconnected as opposed to being separate. So European history is entangled within itself, and also European history as entangled with the non-European, whatever that is supposed to be. Now, the notion of entanglement, in addition, complements a third and very probably more widely known concept, namely the notion of hybridity, which is much favoured, especially by post-colonial theorists. Hybridity refers to the ways in which cultures and identities are composed of diverse traditions, how everything is plural, how everything is a part of something else, and thus there are no self forms or self-forming identities. In place of singularity and uniqueness, the notion of hybridity highlights the mixed nature of social identities and culture more generally. Certainly some identities are more than others hybrid, in that some celebrate more their hybridity than others. And others who do not celebrate their hybridity, like the English one, could also be seen from such a perspective as more hybrid than they might often see themselves. Hybrid forms emerge from prior entanglements, but not all entanglements necessarily produce hybrid outcomes. And, well, you know, one of the aims, we're saying, of a transnational approach to heritage is to identify hidden forms of hybridity, and in doing so to shift the moorings of cultural discourse in more critical and reflexive dimensions. Of course, everything is hybrid, but not everything is conscious of its hybridity. And an approach that is concerned with hybridity would be about highlighting it. And, well, we think the three concepts, hybridity, entanglement, and multidirectionality, are useful conceptual ways of thinking about how history should be conceived in transnational terms as opposed to national terms, and that then has clear implications for how history should be remembered, commemorated in heritage. And that brings us to the next strand on one major dimension of transnational memory that on which there's already considerable literature, namely on migrant diasporic heritage, which I suppose probably has the most literature on it. And Jasper is going to say a few words on that.
So migration is, as Gerard's just said, a key heritage issue. And it's particularly so for Europe, not least, of course, for the continent's own internal migrations, which from the 1700s onwards have shaped our shift from a rural agrarian continent to a predominantly urban and industrialised one. Beyond the need to understand and create public recognition of migration as normal, it is important for two main reasons. First, of course, heritages themselves migrate. And secondly, the categories used to think about, bureaucratically process and ex or include migrants and asylum seekers, are racialized and typologized on the twin legacies of slavery and colonialism. Public discourse on European mass and social media has focused on difference, and especially on seemingly incompatible religious difference. The result is that the right of incoming communities to self-representation and their own heritage is a mess right across Europe. In public policy, control over heritage representation is not seen as a rights issue, more as an opportunity to buy into national narratives that sometimes, as in the UK, celebrate a European-style unity in diversity through multicultural policies. More horrifyingly, perhaps, the pragmatics of exclusion, which have been explored recently in Ruben Anderson's powerful ethnography, Illegality, Inc., demonstrate that concentration camps, barriers, and containment are not just a heritage issue for Europe. From Italian concentration camps in Cyrenaica in the 1930s, to today's fences in Spain's North African enclave of Ceuta and on Italy's tiny island of Lampedusa. So, if heritage is an industry, we do well to remember that migration is too, both illegally with Libyan people smugglers to legally with Frontex, and that the polemical aspects of migration being exploited by Europe's far right help mask Europe's own complicity. This is a complicity in denying both Europe's own historical migrations and its colonial exploitation of the forebears of those who now land on its shores and drown in its oceans. Gerard.
Yeah, and well, in the interest of saving enough time for discussion, and we're already using up already too much of our allocated 30 minutes, let me be very brief with the next section of our paper, which ask the question, in light of all of what has been said, what does it mean to speak of the European heritage as transnational? Obviously, the notion of European heritage as opposed to British or French or German, etc., heritage is already to invoke in some way a transnational perspective. But that is highly ambivalent, as is captured by what is essentially the official motto of the European Union today, unity and diversity, where already a shift has occurred maybe in the last 10 to 20 years, or probably even less, from the emphasis on unity to diversity, where diversity seems to have got the upper hand. And here diversity is really the diversity of national traditions, the diversity of regional traditions, to which we could add now the diversity of ethnic and et cetera, identities, heritages. So does that mean that unity, the unity that might comprise the European dimension, is nothing more than the sum total of all of these? Is it simply the fact of diversity? Where does that leave unity? Is it something that must be given up as being nothing more than the recognition of diversity? And the official position, referring at least to official discourses and, you know, the conceptions of like European heritage days, you know, the European heritage label itself, etc., these official conceptions of Europe, there's an attempt ultimately only to say that Europe is diversity, but that sort of ends up abandoning the very possibility of European identity. And that, you know, might be a conclusion, it might be a reasonable conclusion, that there is nothing other than the fact of diversity. But diversity presupposes something, a matrix or something that makes possible diversity, because it makes no sense talking about diversity if there's not some reference points that constitute and make possible diversity. So I think a very big question now must be posed as to what is unity. I think we have some sense of what diversity is, but we have lost a sense of what unity is. We're sure that the unity of, you know, the past, like grand narratives of European civilization, you know, the familiar story from Plato to NATO, the universalistic conceptions of history, etc., that these were indeed highly problematical. We can question those, but does that mean we only have diversity? Apart from putting diversity into question, it does raise the question of what is unity. So I think it's not irrelevant to talk about the question of unity once again in light of these developments. And we should have a very brief wrapping up conclusion.
Very brief wrapping up conclusion. So the long version of our paper shows how the Holocaust has become a symbol of a public memory that knows no borders, and yet both enables other memories, whilst also enabling European states to gloss over their complicity in other genocides and horrors. Before finishing, I therefore want to take us on a very brief detour to the site of one of those horrors, as it offers insights into how heritage transnationalises and what kinds of heritage might be needed to help heal post-conflict societies. So Mostar's 16th century Ottoman bridge, the Stari Most, or Old Bridge, was of course destroyed by Croat forces in November 1993. It was destroyed because it was seen to represent the heterogeneous multiculturalism of the Mostari, the bridgekeepers. Now, did the international heritage community respond so warmly to the idea of reconstruction and finance it in 2004 because of the genuine symbolic link that it represented between what had become ethnicised and segregated communities during and after the conflict? Or was it just the broader symbolism of a bridge spanning a divide? Instead, we believe that the rebuilding of the bridge represented heritage thinking at its most simplistic. It represented a conveniently clear way to deal with the human and cultural atrocities suffered on all sides. By letting the relatively simple reconstruction of a heritage monument stand as a symbol of an as yet unachieved reconciliation, the international community diluted their focus on the really tricky job of rebuilding Bosnian society. Heritage in post-conflict societies, as the former Yugoslavian territories demonstrate, runs the real risk of being appropriated to tell ethno-nationalist narratives. These simplify and exclude, bringing an apparent clarity to post-conflict identities, classically perpetrators versus victims. What, though, did the post-conflict inhabitants of Mostar choose as their own heritage? Somewhat infamously, a local NGO erected the world's very first statue of Kung Fu legend Bruce Lee in November 2005. I'm asking you, was this a valid choice? Seems to me it was a pretty pragmatic one. Bruce Lee was a global icon. Any other heritage was just too difficult to deal with. And in the aftermath of bloody conflict, who can blame the Mostari for choosing Bruce Lee? In conclusion then, whilst we are critical of the heritage industry because of these simplifications of the past and reifications of national, ethnic and religious categories, we have seen that there is potential in the transnationalisation of heritage for helping to create a cosmopolitan cultural memory. Leaving aside the ethical case for promoting a transnationalising heritage, there are other reasons why Europe should turn its pasts inside out. If we follow Aimé Césaire, we realise that the risk to Europe is great. Hiding from its dark pasts and refusing to do the necessary memory work risks undermining not only the positive aspects of Europe's shared heritage, but also the very existence of the continent. Europe has come too close to the edge, too often, and the spectres of its unresolved transnational pasts continue to shade European identity formation. In other words, if Europe wishes to re-civilise itself, it might well start by looking at its uncivilised transnational heritages. Thank you.
Yeah, good. So I think before we have some discussion, we go to the next paper by Augusto Santos.
But as we change seats.
Yes, good idea. Okay.
Something wrong?
Can you press that one? There you go. That's good.
Okay, thank you. So I was asked to contribute to our thinking with a case study, and I think that with that case study I will consider many of the issues Gerard and Jasper just talked about. The whole question is this one: what happens to the memory, to the representation of heritage when a political regime changes? So the Portuguese case will be considered from that point of view. What happens to heritage when there is a political change so profound as a regime's change, as a revolution? My starting point is this one. There is really a politics of memory and historical identity, and the representation and the administration of national heritage is a relevant issue in that politics. And Portugal is a good example to consider, since after a very long dictatorship, a very strange thing in the Europe of the 20th century, the Portuguese fascist regime lasted from 1926 to 1974. After that long dictatorship, Portugal eventually changed to democracy and in 86 joined the then European community. So what happens when this kind of changes occur? My focus will be on the work of reconstructing a social consensus on heritage, a work led by the Portuguese democracy. So my focus will be the political and symbolic work to reinterpret, to reinterpret the history and the heritage of Portugal in the 70s onwards. From the democratic point of view, three breakdowns, three ruptures had to be done with the former authoritarian representation of history, identity and heritage in Portugal. Because for the Salazar's regime, the dictator's regime, the very foundation of the political regime lied in history. There was allegedly a kind of Portuguese way of being, historically, permanent, of an essentialist way of being. There was the necessity to define politically a canon, a canonic representation of heritage, from which no one could dissent. And of course, there is a huge ideologization of history, since, for instance, Salazar himself was conceived as the Henry, the Navigator of the 20th century. So democracy had to do at least these three ruptures with the authoritarian representation of history, identity, and heritage. First rupture, the break with that idea that there was a Portuguese way of being defined in permanent terms. Secondly, a rupture with that idea that that principle, that the heritage could be defined politically and codified politically in a single canon. There would be a uniform interpretation of history and memory. And the third rupture had to be with that ideological use of history and heritage as the legitimate foundations of the former authoritarian regime. How did the Portuguese democracy deal with that? Well, three issues were critical for this work of de-ideologizing heritage and of rebuilding a new consensus on Portuguese identity. The first difficult issues was colonialism. Colonialism is an historical constant in Portugal since it lasted from the 15th century to the late 20th century. Portugal was the last European colonial empire to break down. So the colonialism, the colonial empire, is a constant of the Portuguese history since the early modern times till the late 20th century. So it was the first difficulty to address. The second was the idea that the Portuguese as well as the Spanish history have to be read in terms of decadence, of decline, of moral and social decline, since both the Iberian states were the first line of the maritime expansion of Europe in the 14th to the 16th century. They ruled vast colonial empires during all the modern age, and they declined eventually until becoming two of the less developed European countries. So this idea that the Portuguese history could be interpreted only in terms of decadence, of decline, from a nation grandiosity to the mediocre situation of the present. And the third difficulty is how to deal with those traditions, that folklore, those monuments, that reading of history that the fascism itself had formatted during almost 50 years in Portugal. How did the Portuguese democracy in the 80s and 90s of the 20th century deal with these difficulties? Well, first, dealing with colonialism. The new consensus that was built in the last quarter of a century in Portugal on heritage is exit in this idea that we can separate discoveries, the discoveries of early modern times from the subsequent colonialism, and we can cope with the colonial past of Portugal in of course in a critical, very critical way, but also as a process that whose legacy is a sort of encounter between people of different continents united by a common language. So lusophony, the idea that the main hyphen articulating nations as Portugal, Brazil, Angola, Mozambique, or East Timor is the language, that global language that Portuguese is, that idea, lusophony, was the factor that allowed it to overcome the negative colonial memory so spread in Portuguese memory. Secondly, the Portuguese democracy dealt with that issue of decadence, reframing it in development terms. The new consensus that was built in Portugal in the last years on the country's past is built on this very important symbolic change. We have to deal with our present and compare ourselves with European standards rather than compare our present to our allegedly ancient grandeur. The third way to deal with the difficulties that the reinterpretation of the past poses in Portugal, the third way was to reinterpret traditions as cultural forms, not as the ideological or symbolic foundations or the revealers of a way of being that was supposedly immanent Portuguese people, but as cultural forms, music forms, literary forms, arts and crafts, and so on. These were, I think, the three pillars on which was built a new social consensus in the Portuguese democracy. So this led to a re-evaluation of Portuguese history in a rather, let's say, transnational way. First, the Portuguese democracy opposed to the authoritarian myth of the Portuguese discoverers and conquerors of the New World in the 15th and 16th century, opposed to that former myth, a new national myth. This new national myth is the leadership Portugal and other Iberian nations in the making of the so-called first globalization in the 15th century. Secondly, there was a new national trade that was gradually being affirmed. This new trade is the presence of a historical constant in Portuguese history, not of colonialism, but of migration. The idea that since the late medieval ages, the Portuguese lived and voyaged and established themselves all around the world beyond the borders of their empire. So the Portuguese reached Japan or reached China or reached Indian regions beyond the Portuguese colonial empire, and that easiness in migration would be one of the most important national characteristics. Third, the idea that the real heritage, the real Portuguese heritage, the real Portuguese, effective Portuguese legacy is worldwide and is constituted by its language. So the Portuguese language would be the first and the main result and outcome of the output of Portuguese history, and this output must be conceived as global because it's a language spoken in four continents by 250 million people. And finally, the idea that the Portuguese were one of the people that most contributed to hybridization, to hybridity, Brazil being the most important illustration of that fact. What I want to focus, to stress, is this, that the representation and interpretation of heritage, of the representation of heritage, of symbolizing the main aspects of a national history, is a crucial element to legitimate any political regime. So any political regime presents its own ideology of heritage. Heritage is a key issue for politics and for policies in any political regime, not only in the authoritarian regimes like the Salazar's one, but also in democratic European regimes. And any regime tries to produce a consensus, a social consensus, on its history and on the memories this history allows for. And democracy, the Portuguese democracy, did so during almost three decades. This process was led by cultural discourse, by political discourse, and by artistic discourse. For instance, the well-known sentence by the most important Portuguese poet of the 20th century, Fernando Pessoa, "My country is the language, my motherland is the Portuguese language," was reinterpreted and reestablished as a sort of national, almost a national anthem, a national proclamation. This consensus is effectively disseminated through education, through the educational apparatus, through media, and through civic rituals and civic institutions, and thus produce social effects on memories, on identities, and on practices. And, of course, has to be deconstructed, both analytical and in terms of cultural policy. For instance, the ideology of Lusophony hides, makes opaque some of the very critical colonial negative aspects of the Portuguese history, because it suggests that the Portuguese colonialism was a special one because the Portuguese were very close to autochthonous people or very easy in the relationship, for instance, with the Africans. And we know from history that this was not the case. So the political consensus that is currently established on heritage, be it established in authoritarian non-democratic context, be it established by democratic institutions, need analytical deconstruction and need policy deconstruction. That is, we have to provide a background, provide the context of interpretation to heritage, monuments, museums, artifacts, memories, traditions, cultural forms. We have to provide a context of interpretation that can go beyond these political readings, this political consensualization, these hegemonic readings of history that we see in every context. Perhaps transnationalizing heritage can be a good way to show the narrowness of the official and widespread hegemonic representations of national heritage and national identity, and of course critical distance, analytical distance, and expertise, scientific interpretation is a crucial element to avoid this re-ideologizing of heritage, even if the ideology is called or named or branded as culture. That is my contribution.
Thank you very much. I think Portugal is a very good example, an excellent example of what a transnational perspective can open up in this case. The example of a nation that was itself a carrier of transnationalism, and what you're describing since 1974 could perhaps be seen as a rediscovery of that. But maybe we can open up now to some questions, comments, and what this might all point to. But would you be so kind to introduce yourself briefly, sir?
Yes, I'm Gabriele Mazza, formerly from the Council of Europe and the United Nations. But first of all, I'd like to really to recognize the value of your presentations, both written and oral. The written contribution, to me, it really struck the perfect balance between scientific investigation and the use of it. Answering concrete questions in future orientation dictated by some values that we that are clearly stated. In that light, you know, the admission of neutrality, which I interpreted such in the beginning, in terms of relative value of transnational versus national heritage, I think we shouldn't be afraid of being less cautious than required. If our goal is to salvage what is left of the European dream and of European construction, then I think we have to look at how to do it. And I think the common heritage, particularly common cultural heritage, has a large part in this. And we shouldn't be afraid of saying it, just as it has a very important, I think, from my angle and my experience, a very important part in the transformation of Portugal into a modern democratic society through the input of international organizations, globalizations, including mine, based on values of the Portuguese society wished to embrace. Now, why not a normative stance? I would say yes, it is good. It's good for Europe and it is good for the world. When we're talking about the Holocaust, the memory of the Holocaust, by the way, the Holocaust is not Heritage Day. It is the day of memory of the Holocaust and all crimes against humanity. 27th January, the day has to do with the opening up of the liberation of Auschwitz by the Russians. That was intended from the beginning, by the ministers of education, later the ministers of the Council of Europe, that proclaimed this day. It was intended as both a European and a global kind of heritage that should be recognized and used as inspiration, contrast, etc. And also by provoking greater identification into these things. So, I mean, this is a day that were celebrated on a world scale, where we would want to know exactly what happened in 19, of course, Rwanda and every 3 years of the company, and so forth. So this is why I do not see any divide. I think a national heritage is too small. Transnational exclusively is also too small because somewhat rootless. I think we need both, even in micro situations. Take Cyprus. There is a great divide, the Turks and the Greeks, you know, and they don't recognize each other's contribution to the life of this island over the centuries, although the memories are there. So through a cultural history, privileges, instances of cooperation and goodwill among the two communities, which after all was the rule of the centuries, strife, conflict was an exception. You know, through that, you know, within the training institutions and history teaching and a bit of research on how to teach that kind of history, you know, that we were able to make a great deal of process of progress. And that was we're seeing in the end as national, the national cultural history, what they have been seeing as a transnational cultural history. Just one word, it was long, but one word on unity and diversity, if I may. I experienced with horror personally this slide away from unity towards diversity. Not because I didn't like the diversity, but first I didn't like the fact that diversity didn't have any qualitative specification to it, and somehow subsumed an approach of total relative moral or other types of relatives. So the difference is not good in itself. But I mean, it was acceptable. I mean, we knew what it meant, you know. But the unity got a little bit somewhat lost. And I don't think we can, in the Europe in particular, and we shouldn't be afraid of talking about unity, whether it's through federal or other type of constitutional arrangements, but there is certainly a common base, a common corpus of beliefs, values, and worldviews, you know, that has to be, and this is an excitement for research and possible with a view to future organization of learning contents should be organized. So, because there is no Europe without a shared core of recognized cultural heritage. I've been there also and for this workshop.
Thank you very much for that. I absolutely appreciate the points you've made, and I take the correction regarding the 27th of January. Further comments? I mean, what do you think about what's just been said regarding unity and diversity? It's like an inoffensive slogan that is appealing because of its vagueness and the unpopularity, it seems, of any talk about unity, because unity is always bad and diversity is always supposedly good. But of course, diversity can mean many different things. It can mean plurality, it can mean divisions, it can mean differences, and there's the philosophical difficulty that any notion of diversity presupposes something wider that offers it the reference points. But that's been lost because of post-colonial critiques of the grand narratives. But we're left basically with nothing, because if everything is diversity, the concept is meaningless.
In fact,
would you mind introducing yourself?
Peter, from Budapest. Mm-hmm. But this slogan or motto can be used by both extremes. The internationalists, they say, yes, unity in diversity, we are diverse, that's nice.
Mm.
Diversity is beautiful. And the nationalists also.
Yes.
That we should be diverse, you just said.
Yeah.
Different. And we should keep our different identities, and these, they are mosaic of these identities which makes the richness of Europe. So this has been, and it is usually not conscious. So people who express this slogan sometimes do not realize that they are using the helping the arguments of their adversaries.
Yes. Okay. That's definitely.
Now, may I ask? I'm a little unsure about our position as a stakeholder. Whether we, of course, lots of things to comment or add to what you said or congratulate. But I don't really know. Although I try to understand that we are going to suggest how, in which way to continue research. Or what is expected from this meeting?
Well, this meeting is more preliminary. The idea is to discuss the topics that we're talking about, and there are going to be two more after the break, and to see if we can identify new questions that have been insufficiently addressed in the existing literature, and to do so in a way that could open up new problems, questions for policy makers and to practitioners. Is that a good way to put it? What do you think, Mercedes?
That's good.
That's what we're supposed to be doing in this session. And tomorrow, yes. Well, hopefully we can advance a bit more, but the discussion today is more with reference to the four papers that were that have been presented, or these might address, as an example, I know you're going to comment in a moment, but as an example, this question of whether it's possible to address the notion of a European heritage in terms of commonalities as opposed to in the terms of difference, and whether a non-traumatic conception of history is possible that also doesn't, you know, gloss over the bad things, but, you know, goes for the uncontroversial things. And in my paper, or our paper, I have posed at least one question. We have other ones, but the question of what happens when different narratives of memory interact. We've talked a lot about the Holocaust, and that's been the dominant one for a variety of reasons, and you've alluded to one important aspect of that. It's a memory that's amplified other ones. It's given for other memories, a language, and perhaps for that reason it's a particularly important one, but also an example of memory that's not self-enclosed because it interacts with these other ones.
And also, if I may, a memory that has, from a critical view, excluded and got Europe off the hook with, for example, with citing the paper, Srebrenica, Rwanda, and other sites of genocide and massacre. So it's still an ambivalent legacy in some ways.
But it's good to always keep asking what we're doing. I'm always asking myself, what am I doing? And I think that's roughly what we're trying to do with reference to these papers, address possible new and interesting questions for research that would be particularly interesting for people like you. The gentleman behind you is going to comment. Would you mind saying who you are?
Yes, my name is Ferdinand Richard. Amongst other things, I am the coordinator of the expert panel of the International Fund for Cultural Diversity, UNESCO, in the last 6 years. And so, of course, we've been abreast with this very fluctuant interpretation of cultural diversity. So I just wanted to stress this idea that we have seen several applications where cultural diversity was a way to exclude, an argument to exclude others. Mm. And that if you see, of course, the Yugoslav war, you can see that some ethnic groups have been excluding others in the name of cultural diversity. That's the thing we have to be very aware of.
That's very interesting.
So there are limits to cultural diversity. This is the first thing. The second thing relates to individuals. I think we all build our cultural diversity as an ongoing process. I'm also living in the suburbs of Marseille in the north since the last 26 years, and I'm very focused on this new generation of fourth generation of immigrants, and they try to build their own cultural diversity on a process that is never finished. And if there are many things we can learn from these people, this is one of them, which is that if we believe that we have a fixed specificity, cultural specificity, including old guys like me, that is a mistake. We are always changing. I don't speak French like my father was speaking French. My kids don't speak French as I do speak French. So this kind of specificity is always on an ongoing process. So you cannot consider unity as something that is fixed versus cultural diversity as something that is fixed. This is a permanent interaction and a permanent tension between the two. I don't think there is an ideal 100% unity, as I don't believe, and the last 6 years at the IFCD was very clear to that there is a specific way to be diverse from others.
Yeah.
So the time factor is something that is central in this question of diversity. The ongoing time passing by.
Yeah, what we need is a new language for talking about questions of unity.
Can I just add, would you buy into the argument then, which we do present in our paper, of Susi Braidotti about becoming minoritarian? So that construction of the self, that individual sense of identity, who you are, is also about decentering the self, not buying into a majoritarian identity, recognizing complexity.
Yes, but these kids in the north suburbs of Marseille, they are from immigration. They call me, and they would call you, and they would call our friends from America, from Australia, Europeans, because they are Europeans, because they are not like them. So they see that like another forced diversity, because at the same time, they want to be French nationals. They are French nationals, actually. And they have, to many extent, they have this kind of very French attitude. I can recognize them everywhere in the world, and they recognize me very well.
Mm-hmm.
So this is something we have in common. At the same time, kids today do not believe in a European identity. They just call us European as an opposite window. But they see themselves as having two identities, which is the world, the global appartenance to the global humanity, and the clan, the family, where they come from. And I think this idea of European identity is just a passage to something that will be global, certainly for the next generations. They don't recognize themselves as being a part, only a part of Europe. They are a part of a global concert, and but they belong to somewhere. And all this is constantly building up, because technology is there, because exchange is constant, and we are talking about, again, we are not talking about fixed values. There are things that are moving constantly. And we have to, I think the academics and the historians have to follow that movement. They cannot stop it. They cannot fix it in a picture. This is not possible.
But that example, which is a very interesting example, where they've got, you're saying, a dual identity, local and global, and what's missing, what's falling out, is the national and the European. Could that be, in fact, something specifically, a new expression of the national, that could also be seen as a new expression of European, even if they don't necessarily use those terms?
If you compare to the US, you see that there is a double identity in the US. Everybody feels that they are very much from the USA. And at the same time, they are very much fixed, either in a state or in an immigrated immigration history. So this is a constant tension. And actually, the people who are not feeling good in the US are the ones that are not belonging to one of these clans, I call them families, big families.
Yeah.
We have the same system in Europe. I'm sorry to be brutal, but I think this question of European identity is fake. It's just a political argument. I don't think it's the reality of the young. The new generations are not
it's
there.
Interesting, Mercedes. I would like to ask you a question, but let Mercedes first. My question would be, could I just meet? It would be very interesting to know how generalizable that could be. I know you don't have the answer. I'm sure you don't have the answer, but it would be very interesting to know how generalizable that example is, or whether it's a French-only example. Would it be relevant to this country? Italy, Britain, I don't have an answer either to that, but it would be interesting to bring that further. But Mercedes, please.
I think that there are a lot of interesting and relevant things that have come up. I was impressed by Mr. Santos' presentation, in the sense that I think that in a way it relates very much also to the Spanish example and to the history that this country has lived in the last 30 years, 35 years after the fall of Franco's regime, still right now it is a moment in which there are internal tensions that prove that this transformation has not possibly really happened everywhere in this country. Now, having said this, there is an issue which I think, and I don't know how it could be tackled, but I agree with what has been said. Diversity is a term that has its very limits, clearly, and unity as well. What I don't know how we could tackle in the development of the project is the idea of unity that, to my understanding, is possibly more linked to what Gabriel was saying, the need to find, identify the common values, views, and beliefs, you said, Gabriel, in the framework of a more political project, which is not necessarily related to the personal identity slash diversity of the individual at a very personal level, but is more related to, again, a political project, which is the European project. The idea of Europe in terms of history is not necessarily the idea of Europe that one should have today in political terms. And that dichotomy, I don't know how we could address it in the project. I come from a family of the diaspora. If there is one, there has been a diaspora in Spain. I come from one such family. And we're the ones that had difficulties in integrating in Mexico, for instance, where we landed finally. But again, I think that I have my mother grew up in the United States, and she always says what Ferdinand has just said. Americans, not USA, but Americans identify themselves as an American from Colorado, an American from California, an American from wherever. I don't know what will happen to the American project in the future with the changes that are happening now, especially with the Chicanos and everything, and the bilingualism that there might have to face in the coming years. But we Europeans have, up to date, not yet achieved this.
Yes.
I think that what we should be able to say in the future is, I'm a European from Italy, I'm a European from Barcelona, whatever.
Yeah.
Sorry, it's possibly not very clear, but
yes,
this issue of a political project slash citizenship, which is not tackled in any of the two papers, is still, I think, somehow quite relevant and should be included at some point.
Oh, the question of citizenship.
Also, yes.
Yes,
both.
Yeah.
The political project and its identification through the idea of citizenship. We're still too linked to our citizenship in nation state terms.
Yeah.
I'm an Italian citizen. I'm not a European citizen yet. And I wonder whether this unity, in historical terms, excuse me, I'll finish now, the only example of a union and diversity in terms of citizenship is the Roman Empire. It's the edict of 2012 Caracalla who says, you're from wherever you are, but you're a Cives Romanus. And you have the right, therefore, to vote, and moreover, you have a property. If you're male, and you know, but you're a Cives Romanus, whether you're from Iberia or Iberia or wherever. That's the only example in European history of a supranational citizenship in a political project. Can we tackle that today?
Well, the Tunisians still remember that you pointed out.
Yes, they do.
Yes, I do agree with you because for me, the idea of an European identity, its strength is the strength of that idea as a political project. And we must put in our academic agenda what has to be done in order to foster, to favor, in cultural and symbolic terms, in the cultural and symbolic dimension, the development of this idea as a political project. The most large political goal of the European integration, the European construction. Without that idea of something that unites us from the diversity that constitutes us, the political project is dead. So I think it's one of the key issues of an agenda such as the social platform tries to build up, is how we can tackle, we can handle, we can propose actions to be taken in cultural cooperation in order to favor the idea that being different and sometimes being antagonistic, we can build together a common house. There is a cultural background, an historical background for this. There is an history of Europe. Europe is a civilization as such, but they are not sufficient. They are not enough. So I see the political nature, the political nature, this kind of utopia that is also in the heart of the idea of the European identity as a strength and not a weakness. And let me answer, if I may, to your concern, what does this have to do with practical things? If I may illustrate with my example, I think one of the most important tasks of a scientist is to put general assumptions in question. For instance, if you read or hear any official discourse in Portugal in any ceremonial or civic ritual the country has, any single politician, any single academic, any single opinion maker says nowadays lusophony is our legacy. I would contest that. You have to do the critique of the ideology of lusophony. The Portuguese colonialism was not softer than the British or the Spanish. The idea that the Spanish were the conquistadores and the Portuguese were the procreators of mulattas is a fake. It's a mistake, an historical mistake. And you must say this even when an hegemonic consensus is built up on that idea. And this has consequences in terms of guidelines for instance, heritage administration. I would suggest that nowadays, the most important thing we could do in order to clearly understand the potential of the Portuguese language is we're acting like this. The Portuguese language does not belong to Portugal. The Portuguese, the most dynamic and plastic movement of the Portuguese language as such nowadays is in Brazil. Still, if you hear the Portuguese people or the Portuguese authority, they speak as if the lusophony meant a sort of historical rights of Portugal on Portuguese language. And same goes to Francophony, and same goes to, I don't know how you say for Spanish, no, I don't know, for Hispanos. And finally, I'm contesting the idea that is current nowadays in Portugal and in other countries of Europe of creating museums of immigration. Because if it's true that Portugal has, we estimate, 4 million people, Portuguese people, abroad, it's also true that in Portugal reside half a million of immigrants. So it does not make sense nowadays to build museums of immigration for some kind of people and museums of immigration for other kind of people. You have to tackle with the migration, mobility, population mobility as such. So I think there are consequences in terms of guidelines for cultural policy and for heritage administration that can be drawn from instance, the work of this seminar.
Yeah.
This is not only theoretical analysis.
Yeah, well, perhaps to slowly conclude the first session, the problem with academics is they question everything and then everything becomes very fluid and difficult to hold on to things. A transnational perspective, you accept the validity of a transnational perspective, especially from a broadly cosmopolitan perspective, tries to show that two things, that things are connected, that nations are connected, and maybe even in the case of Portugal, the country is part of something yet bigger, and of course, at one point of its history, the capital of the Portuguese Empire was in Brazil.
Yeah.
Probably the only example of an imperial history where the capital was no longer in the mother country, but in what was once the colony. Anyway, let's generalize and say Europe is no longer European. But anyway, a transnational perspective for me, I'm proposing to you, is something that demonstrates that the things are connected, that nations are connected, identities, everything is connected, and secondly, that as a result of connections, the things that are connected change as a result of the connections. And I think from that analytical perspective, you can look at things differently, and not necessarily in a way that sets up a dichotomy between the national and the transnational, but shows that the national is already itself transnationalised. And that's, I think, one of the things that was common to the two papers, and I think was reflected in the comments that we've had. And maybe we should take a break now, because just we come back in 10 minutes. And start again at 6. Is that okay? In 10 minutes, coffee break. Thank you.